Welcome to Talk of the Town. Get comfortable. We've got a fantastic show ahead, and you're not going to want to miss a single minute of it.
June is National Fruit and Vegetable Month, so grab your favorite fruit or veggie or try a new one. I love zucchini. Kim, what's your favorite?
Broccoli. I love broccoli. But if we're picking fruit, strawberries are hard to beat.
Strawberries, I'll go with that too.
Well, I'm just getting hungry thinking about food. We've got a wonderful cooking segment from the ladies at Olio and Aceto Tap Room in Stroudsburg. So we're going to learn some great recipes featuring infused olive oils and balsamic vinegars.
All right, by now you know we like to try something different every month. So we paid a visit to a local company that builds the best fire trucks in the world. The Kovatch Corporation is located right in Carbon County, and they put us to work, and I think we did a great job.
I think we did. And speaking of a great job, the 24th annual Carbon County Senior Games recently ended, and the program is really the talk of the town and the talk of the state. Mm-hmm. Other counties are trying to see if they can match the excellent program happening right here in our backyard. We're going to meet the organizers and some of the athletes, too. Oh,
we will. June is also a great month to get moving. With so many options possible this month, it was tough to decide what to do.
It sure was.
So we came up with a way to get exercise, take in some amazing views, and even beat the heat. We grabbed our hiking boots and headed into the woods at Bushkill Falls.
Well, it was beautiful. And something else that's truly beautiful, all the donations from viewers to help the One Love Foundation provide shoes and a variety of other items to children in Sierra Leone. We have photos, videos, and so much more that we're going to share with you about this great organization.
But first, we head out to the family farm. This month, Kim and I got the chance to visit a unique family farm in Mahoning Township, Carbon County.
We learned all about the animals the Keener family has fallen in love with. Alpacas. Mm-hmm. And once I stopped calling them llamas, we learned a lot about these gentle animals.
That's right. Dennis, Evelyn, and their daughter Kira introduced us to the 23 alpacas and taught us all about their family business, from raising the animals to competition and the fiber that makes them famous.
5 years ago, we inherited half of our parents' farm. And we wanted to do something farming. We didn't want to do the usual. And we tried the unusual. So we tried it with alpacas. We started with 3 alpacas 5 years ago. And now we have 23.
Did you know anything about them at that point?
No, I didn't. Same. Really, Murray? I didn't, Kim.
Being able to do things as a family. Dennis and I could do it. Kira could be a part of it. She works with the animals as much or more than we do.
It's pretty fun. For the most part, the hardest part is probably working with them and training with them, because when they're little, they can have quite a temper. And they're not really treat motivated when they're little, so they're a little bit hard to deal with.
We raise them basically for their fleece. Once a year, they get a haircut. And we use that fleece to make different items like yarn and roving and different other products. And we also breed alpacas, so we have babies here.
When we go to shows, there are 2 different types of judging. One is the performance of the obstacle and showmanship, and then the other one is called halter. And halter is when the animal is judged basically on their conformation, mm-hmm. how straight their back is, how they stand, and on the quality of their fleece.
Are you ready?
I love them.
Are you ready? I think she wants to give me a kiss. Do you want to give me a kiss?
This is Tinkerbell. She's a blue ribbon winner, and she's going to demonstrate how to do an obstacle course. And we're going to do better than Marie and Triumph. You ready?
Come on, Triumph. You can do it. Yes. Oh, we got a pace. We've got a pace. I've got to keep up with you.
Come on, Tinkerbell. Come on, you can do it. She's doing a little sideways movement. Come on. Good job. Now here's the big one.
Ooh, this way? No.
This way, through, we gotta go through. Something like that.
So far, so good. Back to the cones.
You don't like this, do you? There you go.
Oh, she's a pro at this.
Very good.
Finally, the teeter totter. She was looking for an early escape.
I go in the hula hoop. You ready? Me, then you. You want to go through there? All right, that was great.
First me. It's been a while since I've done a hula hoop. Now she wants to come visit Jimmy. How long does it take to shear one of these?
Well, probably by 10 to 15 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay. And they handle the bzzz.
They're okay with
yeah,
that?
Yeah, yeah.
We put loops go on each ankle, and then a rope is pulled, and we lay them down. So they're stretched out.
They're stretched out.
Then we have somebody that knows what they're doing with the clipper.
Because you don't want to cut anybody.
When they're all done, they're just a sad skin creature.
But it will start growing soon.
It does. It grows back really fast. It really does.
So we're told this is called the blanket, the best part of the fiber that's been sheared off of an animal. And there's a lot of things you can do with this, right?
Right. This alpaca is so soft.
Really
he's one of our best. His name is Weatherby. So in order to use this for spinning, you can actually take it off the animal. These are called cards. You're going to card it with these hand cards. And what you're going to do is kind of go back and forth, and this lines up all the fibers. So then once it's all lined up, it goes to the spinning wheel.
Kira, you tell us what happens from here.
Okay. From here, you do have to pull it out a little bit. That is called drafting. It's a lot when you first start spinning it, it won't become so big and chunky and it won't break apart as much. And then after you draft a little bit, you can start spinning with it.
And you're just twisting? Is that basically what you're doing? Yeah, just twisting it.
Twist and pull a little, right?
Yeah.
These are all the natural colors of the animals, actually, that colors what you have here in front of you, obviously not.
Right. This is all dyed, all from white yarn, and we use Kool-Aid, unsweetened Kool-Aid packets to dye this.
All right, so your store here is not open all the time, by appointment only.
Right, by appointment only. You can give us a call, and we'll set up a time that's convenient for you, and come in, and you can browse around the things we have, and get a tour, and meet the animals up close and personal.
And you can picnic with the alpacas. The Keener family welcomes you to give them a call and schedule a visit to their farm and store. You can meet the alpacas and even have a picnic with them.
Picnic Woods Alpacas has a gift for one lucky Talk of the Town viewer, a teddy bear.
So soft.
And he is made with the very soft alpaca fiber. Just like the right photo on our Facebook page for your chance to win.
All right, stay with us. We'll be right back with a little quiz. Welcome back to Talk of the Town, everyone. June is National Fruits and Vegetables Month. Do you eat your fruits and veggies?
I eat lots of fruits and veggies.
So do I. We thought a quiz would be fun, and I brought some things to quiz you.
Oh boy, I have some things to quiz you too.
All right, well, the first one's an easy one. Kim, what is this?
Ooh, that would be your basic apple.
Very good. No explanation needed.
No. Good, apple a day.
I'm glad you know what it is.
Eat them a lot. All right, next.
Oh, I know what that is. That's a fuzzy kiwi. I like kiwi. It kind of tastes like a strawberry.
Very good, Marie. I have to tell you, the woman at the cash register did not know what this was. That's
right.
Not good.
Well, pretty much everything in my bin, the rest of everything in my bin, she didn't know what it was either. So we're in the same boat. All right, so what is this?
Ah, that would be a parsnip.
You're right.
Yay.
Very good. I didn't know if you would eat a parsnip, but that was good.
I've eaten parsnips.
Okay.
It's not on my list of regulars. Okay. This is another one, not too difficult.
That's a mango.
A mango, yes.
Good smoothies.
Great smoothies.
Mm-hmm. Like mangoes. All right, how about this?
That would be a turnip.
Very good.
Yay,
turnip with no greens.
With no greens coming out of the top.
They chop the greens off.
All right, you ready?
Yes.
It's related to the turnip.
Is it a rutabaga?
It is called a jacama. A Mexican potato. Sometimes they also call them Mexican turnips.
Okay, yeah.
I've never eaten one of them.
I've never eaten one of those either, but it looks interesting.
They say it's used a lot in salads and also Asian food.
Okay, it's hot today, so it's wilting, so you'll have to excuse its appearance.
Well, it's some sort of a lettuce, maybe?
A leafy green?
Yeah, it's a leafy green.
Do you know its name? It's Asian.
Is it bok choy?
It is bok choy. Yes. Oh,
that was a guess, by the way.
It's bok choy. It's very
you
good.
You helped me.
It's very good sautéed.
I've actually had bok choy. I didn't know.
Yep.
Now this one. Now Marie eats all kinds of weird things. So I thought that I would really have to try and trick her. This I've never had before.
Is that a dragon fruit?
No.
Okay. Because I haven't eaten a dragon fruit yet, and I don't even know what it looks like. But this kind of looks like a pear, but I know it's not a pear.
It is actually, sometimes it's called a pear squash.
Okay.
But it's from Costa Rica, and it is a chibota squash.
Okay. Do you know what it tastes like? Have you tried it?
No. Okay. I have not.
All right. And here was the most confusing one, and I've not ever eaten this. So I wondered if you've ever eaten this or have any desire.
I don't have any desire to eat that, Marie. I'm assuming that whatever is inside of it is probably healthy for you.
I guess. Do you know what it's called?
Is it hard?
Do you even know what it is?
Yeah.
Like, you can't even guess like where it came from or what kind of family it's from.
It's some sort of a tuber, maybe?
Yes, it is a tuber.
And you've never eaten it either?
I've never eaten it either, so I'm going to have to try it after with this segment.
I give up.
It's called a malanga.
A malanga has a cool name.
And it is also, it is a tuber, so it grows like a potato under the ground. And it has apparently like a hazelnut taste to it. So they say it's kind of like a potato, but hazelnutty taste. You would almost think it was a nut instead of a potato of some sort. So a malanga.
A malanga.
Nobody in the grocery line even believed me when I told them what it was, and they couldn't find it in the register either. So that was interesting.
Yes, that is interesting. Well, you know what? Because it's fruit and vegetable months, I think all of you should try something different at the grocery store. Something you've never made before, eaten before.
Good idea.
Catherine, do you eat a lot of fruits and veggies?
Yes, I certainly try to.
All right. So the quiz begins. Ready? Starting with an easy one.
The apple, yes.
Yes.
Very good.
Very good. Success on the first one.
Next one.
Looks like a kiwi.
Very good.
And a mango.
Ooh, 3 for 3.
Of course you would give me that one.
Does it look familiar, but you don't know what it's called?
I don't know what it's called.
It's called a kiwi.
That's right.
Yeah, kiwi, and it has a lot of seeds.
And they're so good.
They are good.
Do you eat a lot of fruits and veggies?
Yeah, I've actually been trying to more lately. My dad just diagnosed with diabetes, so I'm trying to get him on the right track too.
Good.
Well, that's good. How about you? Do you eat a lot of fruits and veggies?
Yeah, definitely.
All right, do you think you can identify fruits and veggies?
I would hope so, yeah.
Shame on you if you don't know.
Apple.
Very good.
Very good.
It's like a Macintosh.
I was thinking that too.
Kiwi.
Very good. Yeah.
Okay. Now it might start to get more difficult.
It's wilting today.
And it's Asian.
Bok choy.
Yes.
Okay. Good
Very
job.
Good.
That's an apple.
Very good. You've eaten these, I take it.
Oh, definitely. Yes. He loves them.
You like apples over there?
Damn.
Yeah. All right. This one's a little harder.
A carrot? A golden carrot.
It does look like a carrot.
Turnip?
Nope.
Rutabaga. I don't know.
It's called a parsnip.
Parsnip?
Yeah. You've heard of them before, but
sure.
Yeah.
What do you think this one is?
Starts with an M, Daniel. We ate it yesterday. Mango.
Did
you like the mango?
Yeah.
Yeah, was it good? Okay.
Yeah.
Trying to get the little guy down here.
He won't get that. That's a kiwi.
Very good.
Kiwis are good. You're doing well.
Yeah.
So far, so good.
I'm edumacated.
Oh, come on.
Tough one?
I don't know.
Looks like a carrot.
Oh, I don't know.
You can guess.
Starts with a P.
I don't know what it is.
Parsnip.
I was going to say that.
Turnip.
That is a turnip. You got it now.
Good
yeah.
Looks like a parsnip.
Very good.
She's good at this game. Okay, now they get a little tougher.
Oh, gee. No, I'm not familiar with that.
Yeah, I never ate it either.
Out of my region.
It's called a jacama. It's a Mexican turnip or Mexican potato.
It's a malenga.
A malenga.
Yeah, and it's like a potato, except more of like
Would you like go all over the world to find these vegetables?
No, just Wegmans.
Yeah, just the grocery store.
Oh, okay.
Well, our fruit and veggie quiz went very well. Congratulations to everyone who guessed correctly. Hopefully you'll think about trying something new from the produce aisle at your grocery store.
Well, and Marie, I know you're always trying new and different food combinations. And I decided I'm going to give it a try as well.
Maybe I'll help you. Maybe I'll bring some new ones for you to try.
Thank you. Well, in fact, we're going to enjoy some great recipes from the Olio and Aceto Tap Room on South 7th Street in Stroudsburg.
That's right. Joining us right now are Cindy Lewis and Barbara Lanucci. Thank you, ladies, for joining us. We appreciate you being here today.
And thanks for having us.
Thank you.
What are we going to make?
Well, this is a very quick and easy salad for summer or all year round. Mm-hmm. Prosciutto and fresh greens, and I'm dressing it with Meyer lemon oil and fig balsamic vinegar, and then doing a little bit of shaved Parmesan on the top.
All right, so what do we do first?
Well, we're going to put the Parmesan on the platter.
Prosciutto, that's like classic Italian ham.
Dried and cured.
Barb knows more about the Italian foods than I do. Excuse my hands.
That's okay.
They are clean.
We all washed our hands.
Yeah, that's okay. Yep. Let's talk about the shop. I know you guys haven't even been there a year yet.
No, we have not. We started in November. I came up with the idea. My husband and I were traveling in Toronto, Canada. We went into a store, and the man that was in there actually did it as he was a bartender. So he served you the oils and the vinegars. And that were all different flavors. But after doing some research, we came up with the fustis idea, fustis, whatever you like to call it, which are silver vessels, and they're stainless steel. They keep the oils and the vinegars at the precise temperature.
It's this lovely thing on the end.
Mm-hmm. And it has a tap on the front that you can taste it in a little cup in the store.
Mm, so you can taste all the different,
all the different
types
kinds
of olive oils and
before
vinegars.
Before you purchase them, yes.
Well, that's nice. Mm-hmm. So you know what you're getting.
You know what you're getting.
And then you can imagine what it would taste like on something like this when you went home. Now, what's that?
This is Meyer lemon oil and fig balsamic. Mm. And I'm just going to dress a little bit on the salad. And I'm going to put some curls of shaved Parmesan.
Ooh, that's pretty.
On the top.
It's really pretty.
Thicker than I would have thought.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking too. It didn't run off really quickly.
They're very syrupy.
And what makes them thicker than the normal balsamics that I'm used to?
I think because they're infused. They're from Modena, Italy. They are infused in California, and we get them from a distributor in Arizona.
Very pretty. Look at how nice that looks.
All right, so now we're supposed to taste. I love salads, so this will be good.
Me too.
Ready?
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
What a nice flavor.
Mm-hmm. And it's different.
It is very different.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. The fig makes a really nice complement to roasted vegetables. If you're entertaining and for an appetizer, you want to put a nice hunk of Parmesan cheese out and drizzle the fig balsamic over it.
Ooh.
That works as well.
This is a nice side.
That's wonderful. And how does, like, doing something like this, an infused olive oil and vinegar, compared to like your store-bought salad dressings? I mean, it has a totally different taste, but, you know, nutritional value and all of that, how does it compare to salad dressing?
Well, first of all, it's pure. There's no additives, no preservatives, no additional sugars. The olive oils are all pure virgin olive oils. So you know exactly what you're getting. Mm-hmm. I mean, you can get things from the store and you can read the labels, but they're full of all kinds of extras where these aren't.
This is the real thing.
Yeah. Yeah, and in an age where we're trying to be organic and healthier, it's mm-hmm. kind of a great idea to go back. This is a wonderful thing.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
All right, now, obviously we've done our vegetable for the day. Now we're moving on to fruit, and this is a surprising thing because I wouldn't think of olive oil or vinegar with fruit. So you've mm-hmm. got a plate of berries here, some of my favorite things to eat,
yes.
really.
Looks delicious.
This is just already great for this time of year. It's strawberries, blackberries, and blueberries. And I'm just going to drizzle it with some chocolate balsamic, which just changes the total flavor of it.
Chocolate. Wow, what an easy dessert. Look how pretty
very,
that looks.
Very
look how
easy.
Long it took you to do it.
Like 2
the
seconds.
The hardest thing
slice
is slicing the strawberries.
Yeah, that's it. And then just taste away.
Wow.
Chocolate is also good on ice cream and cheesecake. You can also use it on brie cheese.
You wouldn't think mm-hmm. that chocolate and vinegar would mm-hmm. even go together.
Well, let's see.
You're
let's decide
it.
If it does.
You will love it.
I know I like chocolate. Wow. I know I like strawberries. Again, we're trying not to make a mess.
Here we go.
Mm. What do you think?
Wow.
I would have never in a million years put vinegar
on fruit.
Mm-hmm. But that chocolate in it is really good.
It's so yummy. I want another bite.
I'm going to try it. I'm going to try a blueberry because I got to think that that's probably just as good.
This is so different.
Mmm, it is really different.
It really is.
And wow, what an easy dessert.
It's just so easy, and it's so refreshing this time of year, and the vinegar actually helps you digest, mm-hmm. which is a good thing, after your meal.
Very, very healthy.
And the beginning of your meal also, it starts to do that caloric process that we all want to happen.
Mm-hmm. That we all need to happen after our meal, so it's good. Yeah, so it's good to have that happen. And when someone comes into the shop, they'll be able to sample all the different olive oils and all the different mm-hmm. vinegars?
Mm-hmm. We have 10 of each, and they're all in their own separate fusti. And you get a little cup, and you can just go around and taste whatever you like, and, of course, buy it to take it home.
Talk about ideas with you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's wonderful.
We also have the
artesian sea salts, and you may taste those as well. Mm-hmm. There's probably 16 different ones of those as well.
Yeah. Wow.
So you have sea salts that are infused with different flavors?
Mm-hmm.
Like what's a popular sea salt flavor?
The vintage Merlot is very popular, which we did bring. There's a ghost pepper, which is very hot. It's the hottest.
You'd like that, Marie.
I'd like that. Yeah.
It's hot.
But because it's very pepper, you know, you don't think of it as a salt, but it's definitely very hot. Mm-hmm. The difference between this salt and a shaker salt is you need literally maybe 5 granules of it in your food. There's a pink Himalayan that actually helps lower your blood pressure.
Oh, interesting.
Which is very,
so the health benefits of real food. And that's exactly. again what we're talking about, mm-hmm. real food.
Very cool. Mm-hmm. Well, thanks so much for treating us to these great foods.
I can't wait. Thank you for having us.
I can't wait to try a bottle of this chocolate balsamic. And there's good news for one lucky viewer. Just visit our Facebook page and like the correct photo for your chance to win a bottle of bacon olive oil mm-hmm. for all the bacon lovers out there.
Mm-hmm. Who doesn't like bacon?
Courtesy of Olio and Aceto Tap Room on South 7th Street in Stroudsburg. Good luck.
All right. Thank you, ladies. When we return, a fire drill of sorts as Kim and I lend our skills to a local crew building a fire truck. Back to Talk of the Town, everyone. We have some work to do today, some heavy work. Are you ready?
I am, Marie. And that's because we're at the second largest fire truck manufacturing facility in the entire country, KME Kovatch.
And it's right here in Nesquehoning.
Let's get busy.
You know, this is a fashion statement I never thought about.
We build a fire truck from the ground up. And we're the most totally integrated and customized fire truck manufacturer in the United States also.
We're geared up and ready to go.
We're going to be joining two pieces of metal with 11,000 degrees of heat and a small arc flame.
Time to get welding.
Hit it, Erica. So how'd we do, Erica?
That's not bad anyway. Well, it's on to the next task.
Let's go.
Okay, Dennis, this looks like a giant engine, am I right?
Yes, it is. Very
great.
Big.
Good
450
job,
horsepower.
Yes.
So what are we going to do?
Well, what we're going to do is we're lowering it into the frame rail, which is custom built. And basically what we want to do is guide the motor mount into the bushings, onto the frame rail.
This sounds like a really important part of the whole process.
Very important. Right. If this isn't done correctly, then we have problems from here back.
Okay. And you trust us?
I do.
Yes, good. Good answer. All right, let's get started.
Okay.
Well, it's close. Mine's in.
What, the garage or?
Not going anywhere.
Success. We put the engine in place.
Good job.
We'll
it's time to bring it
to
down.
Down.
Nice and easy. Yes.
Mm-hmm. And Marie, you didn't leave any tools in there, did you?
Nope.
Now, this fire body is ready to go onto this to the chassis. So what we're going to do is we're going to lift it up and put it onto the chassis itself, and we'll fasten it down.
I hope we get some help.
Yes.
No, lots of help.
Looks,
don't worry about
looks
that.
Looks really
lots
heavy.
Of
up, up. Good job, guys. Over. Keep going this way.
Okay, ready?
Yep. Good job.
The work ethic of the people in this area is second to none. I love it. It's the people that make a great company. The bricks and the mortar and the buildings that we have and the equipment can't even begin to do the job without the good people. And we have the best people in this area that anybody could find.
And you just want to go slow and steady. So all you do is keep it flat against it. And you don't want to stay in the same spot. We're out in a compound, because then you'll burn through, and then I get in trouble.
You don't want you
get I don't
want
to get in trouble.
There we go. Okay. You don't have to go to the gym afterwards,
just
do you?
Keep it flush. Just keep it flush a little bit.
If we have to repaint it, we want it pink.
Yes, hot pink.
Deal. That's a deal. Okay. I'll bluff my first pink fire truck.
Now listen, guys, you guys really got to get this truck done. You're running my man hours. That's all we got. Let's get her done, all right.
All right. So this is really where all the bells and whistles
this
happen.
This is the final line, yeah.
This is easier than buffing.
Yeah.
All right. Hey, it works.
It works.
We made a door.
Very good.
Well, you guys did a great job. And don't worry about those couple mistakes.
You'll take that. Care of them?
Yeah,
good,
fine.
Thank you.
Good, thanks.
But listen, we have to get this truck up to Pocono Raceway, so get going.
All right, thank you. All right, let's go. I wonder how fast this thing goes. Talk of the town, we'll be right back.
Welcome back to Talk of the Town. The Summer Olympics will take center stage in London next month, but in Carbon County, hundreds of senior citizens took part in their own Olympic Games of sorts, testing their skills in everything from mini golf to swimming, ping pong, and even bowling.
That's right. The Carbon County Senior Games is one of the largest and most successful events in the state, and the seniors we met really enjoy the competition and the camaraderie.
Let the games begin!
How are you doing in the dart competition today?
Not as well as I'd like to.
Ooh, but you're still on top. Did you know that?
Yeah, I know. But I want to stay there.
Come on.
is to have fun. I'm enjoying it no matter what my score is.
It is so much fun. Just get out and do something.
To dance, and we love the music and the people. It just makes it so
much fun. It was a lot of fun to be here with all our friends.
One of the most notable things about the 24th annual Carbon County Senior Games is how much fun all of the athletes were having. Every day I witnessed so much laughter and cheering, even for opposite teams. This really is a great event.
Yes, it is. And joining us is the director of the Carbon County Senior Games, Ann Horrigan.
Hi, Ann.
Hi.
Thanks for coming.
Thank you for having me.
Have you recovered?
Oh, yes. Oh, yeah. Just about. I wonder if the athletes recovered, you know. They were doing all the exercise and all the moving.
They do. The Senior Games in Carbon County are so special, and you should be so proud. The event is just such an awesome event. How does it make you feel to have something? It's really the envy of the state.
Thank you. Well, it does. It makes us feel proud. It gives you a sense of accomplishment when you see the people coming out, laughing, making friends, you know, trying their hardest. And if they don't make a ball, if they don't make a basket, they're still laughing about it. And it does make us proud. It takes a lot of time, but it's certainly worth it.
For the person who doesn't know anything about the Carbon County Senior Games, you have to be 60 years old or older, right? Mm-hmm. Tell us about the teams. It kind of goes back to those days of high school when the high school rivalries were going on.
Absolutely. It's the same thing as if you had your Lehighton High School, your Palmerton High School, and everybody when they'd get together on a Friday night for a football game. It's the same feeling where you have people from Panther Valley, which encompasses Summit Hill, Nesquehoning, and Lansford. Jim Thorpe, which also includes the Penn Forest area and Kidder Township. Weatherly, which includes Weatherly, Beaver Meadows, Tresco, all Carbon County towns. And then we come down to, of course, Lehighton and Palmerton.
Mm-hmm. Do you have one area that's more talented than the others?
Well, I think they're all very talented, I must say.
You're really such a diplomat. I know it's always the North versus the South kind of, too.
Yes, it is.
That was new for this year.
Mm-hmm. We actually combined teams. The North is Panther Valley, Jim Thorpe, and Weatherly. And the South, of course, is Lehighton and Palmerton.
And it was a much closer competition.
Absolutely.
But I know that when you're there, the athletes are always talking about recruiting more people. And I know that would make you happier than anything to see more people come in and more people using your senior centers all year round.
That's very important, yes. I don't know if people realize, but our Lehighton Senior Center has a gymnasium, pool table. It has a lot of equipment, basketball hoops, that people are welcome to come all year round and practice.
That's why they have the edge down here.
Yeah, maybe.
You never know.
If it does get any larger, we may have to find a larger gymnasium, a larger venue.
That's right. A wonderful problem to have.
Yes, yes.
And I have to mention Victor Patuk, because I remember, I think, when the Senior Games first got its start, I met Victor, and he's a force.
Absolutely, he's a force. He's a retired athletic director. He worked at Jim Thorpe School System for years. That was his whole career. And he used to put on wonderful gym shows for everyone, and the public would all come out and see it. very organized, very meticulous, and a great guy.
Yeah. 83 years old now, and newly married.
Yes.
So I mean, still a huge force.
He's
probably
still going.
Really looking forward to the 25th anniversary next year.
Yes, we are.
Anything special going on for it, or just more of the same, hoping to recruit more people?
We hope to recruit more people, and we'll probably have something special. We don't know what that is yet, but I'm sure we will.
You know what? I remember everyone laughing and having a good time. I was there during the mini golf, and it was amusing to me because there was a long line waiting, and everybody was very calm and waiting for their chance to get on the mini golf until someone hit a hole in one, and then it went crazy.
Yes.
And then
yes.
They're celebrating at the ice cream stand, too.
Yes.
So
yes.
It's just a big party is what it seems like.
Yes, that's what I said. Actually, everyone, sure, they want to win medals, but they also are happy for their fellow competitors.
Yeah. Sometimes I try to egg them on to do more of the competition, and you know what? They really are friends crossing towns.
Yes.
And they've made great friendships over the years.
Yes, they
through
have.
The senior games.
And that does a world of good for anyone.
So what would you say to the person sitting on the couch who hasn't been involved in this?
Just try it once. Just try it once, come out, and you will see. You'll be there. You'll be hooked.
And here's something else important for, I think, the person at home to know. I mean, how old was the oldest person in senior games this year?
Well, I think 89.
I was going to say.
Yes.
So, and you don't have to do every event.
No.
You can do one, you can do them all, you can do the two you like, and it's all fine, right?
Yes, we have people that just come out for the outdoor events because they know they excel in horseshoes.
Mm-hmm.
We have people that just come to play pool. They bring their own cue sticks.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they're the scary ones.
They actually intimidate. I'll tell you, one of the comments from someone I know, they were intimidated because they saw them bring their own cue stick. My answer to them was, bring your own.
Yeah, exactly, right?
You've got one at home, just bring
it
to
you. Bring one, or bring anyone, and they'll think it's yours, you know?
That's right. Well, and you also have the card category. So for somebody who isn't physically able to do some of the things,
that's right.
Like the bowling, they can sit and play cards, and
absolutely.
That's a category. So that's, you know, where you can really get the wide range of ages.
Yes.
And bingo.
Bingo? Years ago, actually, we had checkers for that reason.
Wow.
But people who played checkers, it actually went on too long. Our senior games would have had to add another week to it. So we did have to discontinue checkers. Yeah. But it was fun. It was nice when we had it.
All right. Well, we want to help you, encourage everyone to get out and be part of this. Thank you very much for being with us today. We're going to give information on the senior centers so that people know that now it is the off season. But if you're 60 or older, you could be a new recruit. You have to be old to go for the gold. So get involved with your local senior center now and get ready for Senior Games 2013. Put it on your calendar, May 7th through the 16th, 2013.
Well, you're really marking on your calendar.
Mark it on
ahead
your calendar.
For that one. All right, stay with us. Next, we get moving with a great spring and summertime activity. Welcome back to Talk of the Town, everyone. You know we like to get moving, and today we decided it's the perfect day for a hike.
It absolutely is, and a hike can be anything you want it to be. You can travel at a fast pace or a really relaxing pace, pick a really challenging trail with lots of rocks, or something really flat and easy.
And today we're at Bushkill Falls because it's the perfect place to get your hike on.
That's right. Diane Hannon is with us. Thanks for having us here today.
It's a pleasure to have you here at Bushkill Falls. Welcome.
You are the spokesperson for Bushkill Falls. You've
Correct.
Been to this place a lot. Tell us what we're going to see today.
Well, you're going to see what Mother Nature provided us here in the Poconos. Since 1904, Bushkill Falls has been here, and we've been host to over 250,000 visitors every year. So you're going to get to see what they come to see every year.
Hey,
wow. Let's get going.
Let's go for a hike.
So to get started, people have to be aware that this is actually out in the woods.
Exactly. This is all natural. This is the way the Peters family founded the property. And so you are walking in the woods, so it's best to always wear comfortable walking or hiking shoes. Because you'll see that the pathways and stairs that are designed to assist you going up and down the trails are rugged. So it is important to have that ankle support.
Marie wanted to hug a tree.
Hug a tree. It's a big tree.
All right, so Diane, there's lots of choices as far as trails are concerned here. Easy, hard. Tell us about that.
Correct. There are four different trails. There's the Main Falls Trail, which is the easiest, the popular route, which is in between. Then you have the Bridal Veil Falls and the Pennell Fall Trails. And you'll find that the Bridal Veil Falls is the one that's the red trail that people can buy t-shirts and hats that say, I survived the red trail.
How many miles but is it, or how long is that trail?
That's about, to do the entire red trail, you're looking at about 2 hours and 30 minutes, about a little over 2 miles, and it's actually through the woods.
Diane, how many falls are here?
There are 8 waterfalls. And the signature one, of course, is known as the Main Falls, which we'll see shortly at the lookout.
How many visitors a year do you have come through Bushkill Falls?
We have approximately 250,000.
Wow!
In 1917, we have an ad in the Interpretive Center that you can see from 1917, and they had 20,000 visitors back in 1917.
Visitor not too long ago. Tell us about that.
We did. In September of 2011, Charlize Theron was here and was photographed by the famous photographer Annie Leibovitz. They had her right on the cliff, and then further up at the beginning of the Bridal Veil Falls is where she was actually lying in the stream on a rock.
Wow, and they were here for a whole day, and you said they ended up publishing 3 pictures out of that?
It was 3 pictures, exactly.
Onward
and upward.
Like it's brown, and those are natural effects because the little Bushkill originates in a swampy area on top of the Pocono Plateau.
We talked about the fact that Bushkill Falls is a hidden treasure. Some people don't know it's here. What do you want to tell the people about this place?
They forget that there are treasures in their own backyard, and Bushkill Falls is that. It's been here since 1904, so it's a perfect place for people to come and spend a day, bring the entire family, and have a great outing.
Definitely a very relaxing day.
Oh, I know, it's been a great day, but you know what? We're all the way up here. Now we have to go back.
It's different from an amusement park where you're standing in line, there's lots of noise, lots of rides, lots of music. Here it's the sound of the waterfalls, it's the sound of people speaking with each other, or just not even saying anything, just taking a walk and enjoying the environment.
Bushkill Falls really is beautiful, and it's a wonderful day trip for the whole family. In fact, it's so much fun, we want you to explore this treasure. Our friends at Bushkill Falls have a family 4-pack of tickets for one lucky viewer. Just visit our Facebook page and like the right photo for your chance to win. Good luck.
All right, when Talk of the Town continues, we find out how your donations have helped children in the war-torn country of Sierra Leone. Don't go away. Welcome back to Talk of the Town, everyone. It's time to talk about the power of a very small group with lots of community support.
The One Love Foundation is based in Summit Hill. The organizers say the generosity of people in our area is unbelievable.
Director Maria Stianchi, hi Maria,
hello,
and her brother Chris Izzoni recently got the chance to visit Sierra Leone firsthand to see how their group is changing lives. We welcome both of you. Thank you
very much for being here. That must have been an overwhelming experience to go there.
It was incredible. It was really incredible. Beautiful country, beautiful people.
But it's got a very checkered past.
Oh yes, they have had a small country devastated by war.
Well, you guys thankfully took lots and lots of pictures while you were there. We're going to share a lot of them with our viewers now so that we can see firsthand what you guys got to see. And yeah, the first thing was shocking how the people looked and what they had to deal with in their lives, but also the hope that they have. So tell us about the people in this community and why. I mean, we see this woman she has amputated arms, and I know that this was something that was throughout the community.
Yeah, this community, as you can see, they were devastated by the war. The war was brutal, and as most civil wars are brutal, and they were basically left to just try to survive the war and rebuild. How do you rebuild when you've gone through something like this? And I can tell you, they have hope now from all the people in this area that have contributed to this project.
Right, look at, there's more of them, and you see more St. Peter's and Paul's shirts. So they were celebrating that day, showing off that they knew who you were and that you were coming from our area. We also have some video of, and this is where you can really see the hope and how amazing these people are. Yeah. They're playing soccer. Maria, that's you in there with them playing soccer.
Well, I wasn't quite as good as them.
No, but look at how amazing that is. Talk about overcoming whatever your challenges are in life.
Those are some of the crutches. There were several pairs of crutches and some wheelchairs that went to the people in this community had donated from our area. Chuck Thomas in Lehighton Health Solutions that donated an oxygen concentrator, gave us some crutches as well. Mm-hmm. And as you can see,
they're not slowing down.
It doesn't slow down.
These guys play every Saturday and they practice, and they are quite good. And it's part, the whole community shares in playing soccer. Wow. Sports bring a community together, and they love it and they enjoy it.
They get big crowds watching them?
Oh, the whole community, everybody.
Everybody's there.
Yeah, everybody. There's at least 300 or 400 people in this amputee community.
And talk about why they're amputees, because I don't think a lot of people know that. That happened during the Civil War. Instead of killing people, they would cut off their arms and legs.
By a machete. As I said, civil wars are brutal, brutal, even in our own country, bloody wars. And they basically, especially these people in this area, suffered by the rebels that came in from outside and basically amputated them to terrorize them, to intimidate them into voting.
Okay. You know, thank goodness. Their spirit has prevailed.
Absolutely.
And now they're doing new things. We talked about the St. Peter's and Paul's and all of the support from St. Peter's and Paul's, but there's also something that these people are doing there to help support themselves in their town now, and they're making soap. Tell us about that.
Well, when we met in Palmerton and had a meeting with the One Love Foundation with Father James Sandy, who is our other side over there, we talked about basically these people, they don't want a handout. They just want to be helped to help support themselves.
That's mm-hmm. wonderful.
It's been bringing them to a place of sustainability. And this community, these women were so excited because we went into this community and gave them a way that they can support themselves. They're making laundry soap. Oh, and they'll be able to sell that to support themselves. And you know what? It smells really good, too.
I bet it does. Were they really happy, Chris, to get their pictures taken doing that and proud to show you what they were doing and what they were up to?
They're very proud that they are able to do this for themselves. They are proud that they are able to have the dignity mm-hmm. of providing for themselves.
And I can tell you, they love the people back here for giving this opportunity also.
Being able to thank the people that, that's just an awesome thing.
And okay, so they have cows now. So you're mm-hmm. teaching them how to be farmers as well?
well, kind of. The farm project started from the Lansford Outreach Group. In Lansford, in 2008, they came up with an idea that they had met with Father Sandy, said, how can we help you become sustainable? And they started with chickens mm-hmm. and goats. And we had hoped maybe someday we would get cows.
And it happened.
And as you can see, there is our one
that's a big
mother cow.
Cow.
And that is our first baby calf.
Your first baby calf.
Yes.
And that's got to just be a success story in and of itself. Because now you know it's going to continue.
Absolutely. And we have two more cows that are pregnant.
Ooh.
So one was born in December and January, and two more on the way.
All right. So that helps
that's
them.
Wonderful.
And there it is. And this video is great. You guys were posing with the cow, and somebody was holding its leg up so it couldn't run away. Yeah, look at you, Maria. You're creeping away.
There was a lot of flies.
Talk about water, too, because I know Sierra Leone has an issue with water.
We couldn't go 2 hours without water, and these people had no water at all. And I can tell you that thanks to St. Vincent de Paul Society, had provided the first pump mm-hmm. For one of the wells that was dug, and we now have two more wells, and that amputee community in January, we got them their first source of water. They used to have to walk several miles into town to buy water or drink out of the river.
Wow.
And they were very, very welcoming to us because it was the first time that they had clean water, and it came from all of the supporters of the One Love Foundation.
When we first talked to you last year, it was because we were doing our Let Them Walk in Our Shoes campaign, and we always try to reach a little farther and find somebody else in the world who can benefit from the shoes that we've collected. Mm-hmm. And we, when we called you and said, hey, would you like 3,000 pairs of shoes?
Yes!
And of course you said yes. And
as long as they fit in the container, right?
And you guys started with a big empty shipping container.
Yes.
And not only our shoes, but everything you had, you jammed as much as, I know you have experts that can pack.
We had a trailer in there. We had a tiller to help with them now for their farming.
You can see bicycles and whatever you could. But our 3,000 pairs of shoes are in there somewhere.
They are in there.
And then you were able to be there. And it, I don't know, it makes me so happy just to get the firsthand, you know, from you two, the firsthand experience of handing those shoes out to the kids. And for the our viewers who dropped, the little kids who took shoes to school from
I was there during the packing at the armory, and they were beautifully packed, and the ROTC was there and the National Guard, and it was to me, it was incredible to actually see them going on the feet of the people that everybody intended. It was beautiful.
So what kind of reaction did you get? Some of these children never had shoes before, right?
And now they're getting Nikes.
I know. Oh, you should have seen the response for them.
It was overwhelming. The kids were ecstatic. The parents were so excited to have their kid go up. And each child got a Laffy Taffy after they got their shoes. And that went over big.
Shoes and candy. And this was like graduation day, yes?
This was in 2010 of April, we were actually able to build our first preschool. A lot of the school desk from some of the old school buildings in Lansford supplied that, and school supplies that were sent over. And this is the first graduating class.
Oh, the first graduating class, and they had shoes
We were able to hand them out the diplomas and shoes. And also shoes for the whole entire community, all the children that even weren't in the preschool.
And that's Father Sandy.
That's Father Sandy.
So Father Sandy was really, spearheaded this whole thing when he came here. He made people here realize what kind of help his people
And trust me, it's not easy to get to these villages. These are difficult. There's difficult roads to get there. We were up early in the morning and through over bridges and
craziness.
Sort of like bridges.
Yeah.
And you've got, in that one picture that we see up there, you've got a pair of Crocs, some star sandals, and ruby slippers. All in the same picture.
The ruby slippers caused quite a little
a
frenzy.
Stir.
Is there some grabbing going on?
I wanted them.
Oh, you wanted them too. What do you want people here to know about your trip and what the people there thought about what we do for them here?
When we walked into, there are things from Sierra Leone, from all over Panther Valley, through Palmerton, all the way out to Strasbourg. I mean, you guys even brought us even further.
Princeton.
And that we were welcomed when we walked into a community, when people who didn't have water have water.
Mm-hmm.
They have
shoes.
They have food.
Mm-hmm.
I hope our pictures are going to show you what you have done for those people. You've changed their lives, and everybody is extremely, it's brought hope. Mm-hmm. The amputee community especially, that was the thing they told us, they expressed to us, is we have hope now.
Hope now there's going to be
good
things
to come.
We have our own money,
we have our own way to provide.
Speaking of money, I know you wanted to mention too that you guys did take this trip to Africa, but you didn't rely on the foundation to send you there. That was all your own.
We didn't want to use any of the money. My father actually bought our plane tickets, which were very expensive.
Thanks, Dad.
Yes, thank you.
Yeah.
Mario Izzoni from Summit Hill.
But that allows you to do more.
Yeah, we didn't want to take any money away from, as you can see, the worthwhile projects.
Absolutely.
Are you still collecting now, and where do we go from here?
From here, we actually have somebody that is sponsoring the amputees soccer team. They won us some official jerseys, and cool. Valley Athletic is right now looking in Lansford, looking into getting us jerseys.
Oh, that's
and we,
wonderful.
The one thing I will say we are collecting is I will take forearm crutches that you see.
Oh, that they were playing soccer?
Yes, if they can contact us through the website, we do want to send them more of those over there. Mm-hmm. And of course, soccer shoes too.
cleats. Soccer shoes, cleats
are good.
Yes. Cleats are any sneakers probably. Good. And some of those boys have bigger feet, so maybe if you've got teenage kids.
Yes.
Right.
Like my son has big feet. I'm going to send you some of his shoes.
8, 9, 10, I think is pretty much the range. But I mean, it brings this whole community. They are happy people. Yeah. We don't need to really feel sorry for them.
No,
we just gave them a helping hand, and they are in so much a better place. Fast forward 10 years post-war, they are educated. These children are beautiful. They are educated, and they are well. They are fed, and they are secure, and they are happy. They are like a family now. These orphans are really a family, and everybody who has contributed, you know, it's not us. We are just the people showing you back what you've done, and they love everybody in this area. They say people from this area have such big hearts.
That's nice.
And
nice, and they do.
They do.
Yeah,
they do.
Well, Marie and Chris, thank you so much for being with us. We really appreciate hearing your stories and learning, you know, what happened to all those shoes. What happened to all
wonderful.
Those shoes?
And everything that we sent over.
Yeah. And they're still being distributed because 3,000 shoes is a lot of shoes.
Well, if you would like to know more, just visit the website at onelovefoundation.org. And remember, whatever you do, be
the talk of the town.